I got a call from Dr. Sandra Lee. She called and she reached out about a patient, but Roger's case was extraordinary. He doesn't really fit in a plastic surgeon's office. He's not really a cancer case. He doesn't fit in a head and neck oncologist's office. So he would fall through the cracks in a normal situation.
I am so excited about this and what it's going to do for him. I know it's a long time coming.
Yeah, absolutely.
We're happy that our foundation is able to kind of contribute.
What is this foundation?
It's the organization that has allowed us to travel around the world and do these missions internationally completely free of charge for patients. So the foundation is actually covering anesthesia, OR costs, I mean, literally everything that has to do with the surgery.
You just gave me goosebumps. I mean, there's so many moving parts that were necessary to allow this to happen. Yeah. This is a big deal. This is a three-pronged procedure. First is the intubation and anesthesia, and this is risky because of a potential airway obstruction. Number two is the removal, which is risky because of the loss of blood. And number three is reconstruction.
Just the sheer size of the tumor, it's completely blocking his nasal passage. And the second one is blocking access to the oral cavity. And normally when we put someone under general anesthesia, we have to be able to give them oxygen. We know somehow we've got to get him under general anesthesia without having normal access to either his nose or his oral airway. We'll have to put a small incision in the neck, open the actual windpipe, the trachea, and then put the tube in there, and then hook him up to the anesthesia machine. Do you have any questions for us?
When are we gonna start?
When are we gonna start?
You're excited,
great question.
I want to get this heavy weight off me.
Yeah, you've been waiting a long time to get this done.
So. All right, so Roger, we're going to start by shaving your beard and mustache, and just so we can see what's going on with the rest of the skin. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Roger is having his beard shaved for a few reasons. It really is obscuring our ability to see the area very well. And certainly it can be a nidus for infection. It takes away some complication from this already very complicated surgery.
When you wake up, how are you gonna look?
Handsome.
Handsome, that's the right word. Awesome.
Why don't you get at the head, Lori?
All right, young man, you ready?
Dr. Osborne is taking a tube with a camera to be able to see down into Roger's windpipe. And once he sees there's an opening to his lungs, he's gonna pass a tube that contains oxygen to be able to supply his lungs so that we can breathe for Roger.
Nothing. No CO2 back.
All right. A little bit more, see if you see. Okay.
Sivo. Roger?
I don't like it. Let's get him some oxygen.
So the anatomy of Roger's larynx is not normal. This means that Dr. Osborne cannot properly pass a breathing tube into this passageway. So really, Dr. Osborne has to move to plan B. Dr. Osborne is going to make a little opening that allows Roger to breathe, which is a tracheostomy. You're no longer breathing out of your nose, your mouth. You're breathing out of a hole at the base of your neck.
Skin incision.
A tracheostomy is not a simple process. The hole is created in your windpipe, and this may sound really extreme, and certainly it does introduce some more risks. It's something that would want to be avoided unless necessary. But here, we deem it necessary.
We have CO2, we are in.
Okay. Yay.
Luckily, the tracheostomy worked, so Dr. Osborne and Dr. Hamilton can now continue with the procedure.
All right, let's get started.
Incision 33.
This tumor will bleed. The worst thing that could happen is Roger could die from this surgery. All right, let's get started.
Incision 33.
You could lose so much blood in a matter of minutes. It would be nothing for him to be in cardiac arrest if someone were just to try to lop this off, there'd be no way you would stop that bleeding.
Dr. Osborne has just made his very first incision into Roger's rhinophyma, and bleeding is a major concern.
Blood runs from high to low. So if we started with this one, which we saw, it bleeds a lot. All that blood's gonna run down into our field, so we'll start low and deal with the bleeding here. We have this sort of model, go slow to go fast. And essentially what that means is take your time, identify the blood vessels, control them, rather than just cutting through them. So we've got a circumferential skin cut without too much blood loss. That's nice. But I can already see a big vein right there. Mm-hmm. Bipolar.
Dr. Osborne is using a bipolar electrocautery tool, which really allows you to seal the blood vessels as well as cut it at the same time. And sometimes there's some bleeding despite that because the blood vessels are so large. And that's why Dr. Hamilton's coming in with a little vacuum and pulling up that fluid, because if there's too much fluid in the area, the cauteries don't work.
Last little piece now. Mm-hmm. Here it comes. There we go.
Wow, they removed that entire huge piece with very little bleeding. So that is in itself a huge victory. Even if nothing else happens today, we've really improved Roger's breathing, removing that first big lump. But these doctors are just gearing up to tackle that second larger growth. There's tape placed over Roger's eyes, and this helps because he's under general anesthesia. Sometimes if you're laying back, maybe your eyes might open, and we want to protect his eyeballs, certainly.
The biggest challenge here, I think you're just gonna go straight across something, like I'm just gonna lop it off. You're gonna end up lopping off part of his normal nose.
I mean, that looks like a
portobello mushroom.
Yeah.
Coming off.
You say portobello, I say potato. The skin could accommodate so much there. Dr. Osborne was able to successfully remove the superior tumor as well. Most importantly, he allowed there to be extra tissue there to really aid in proper reconstruction of the nose. Dr. Hamilton is a plastic surgeon who works really closely with Dr. Osborne at the Osborne Head and Neck Institute. He's one of the best plastic surgeons around, but reconstructing Roger's nose to become a fully functional nose may be his greatest challenge yet. So these are the two specimens that you removed. This is your portobello mushroom, and that was my Idaho russet.
That's right. Got a lot of fibrous tissue to this one.
It looks like a big hunk of skin.
A little bit like whitefish, I suppose.
I think you're enjoying this. You're going to cut through all your tissue off now. Sort of looks like when you cut through a scallop, actually. It's got that kind of whitish look, and it's sort of that rubbery texture when you feel it. But it's not a scallop, it's rhinophyma.
Honey, open your eyes. Hi, we are finished.
Hi, you look fantastic. This is one of the most amazing transformations I've seen. Certainly, I'm so proud to be part of it as a dermatologist here, and it's gonna look even more amazing when we give Roger some time to heal. You look so good.
Remember, when you woke up, you were gonna feel awesome and look
handsome. I am so proud of Roger. He has been through so much. Many people would have given up when he persisted. There were many times he came to my office where he was thinking that he was going to have something removed, yet he was sent back home. And I'm really, really proud to be a part of helping him just become a normal member of society, which is such a basic thing that we all take for granted. He's going to be able to go to the store, just not feel like people are looking at him or staring at him. He no longer needs to hide, and now he can thrive.